Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you for your word. Your word is the truth. We receive your word written in our heart, written in our mind. Thank you for the revelation of it. We will be hearers and doers of it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated, if you would. We've been sharing with you on the subject of the fruit of the Spirit. Very important. You know, he knows us by our fruits. If we don't have fruit, there's a problem. God wants us to have fruit. We've seen in the past, as we've talked about, how our fruit is better than gold, how it makes you stronger than your enemies, how it comes through the Word of God in you, and how if you don't have fruit in your life, then, you know, that's how God knows you. Then there's a problem. The guys that don't have fruit, he's cast away as a branch, thrown in the fire. We saw that in John chapter 15. And we've talked about the fruit of the Spirit, some of the ones so far, as we see in Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there's no law. We talked about love. Love is agape love, a love that realizes the valuableness, the preciousness, and the importance of an individual and also of God. We talked about love towards God and how much that when we love God, those that love him, the blessings of God will come upon us. We saw also that if we don't have love towards one another, we're nothing. We must walk in love at all times in our life. We also saw the fact that we are to have the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is our strength, our fortified place of protection. The joy of the Lord has nothing to do with your circumstances. It comes on the inside from the Word in you. And as you allow the joy to come in you through the Word, and you continue to rejoice in the Lord, especially in the time of temptations, as we saw, then you're going to be able to overcome. And actually, we saw that joy protects your faith. Joy is that which causes you to be in a fortified place of protection from the enemy. And we even saw that it's a spiritual bucket that draws the water out of the wells of salvation on the inside of you. If you didn't hear that message, you ought to get it and listen to it. It's an important message. In fact, if you don't have joy, it means you've dried up. And where is the fruit? Without the joy, we should have the fruit in our life. God wants your joy to be full, and that's as you become one who bears much fruit and keep the commandments and see your prayers be answered. We also talked about the covenant of peace. We pointed out that peace is not talking about just peace of mind. When you talk about peace, we're talking about a peace that brings forth that in all aspects of our life. We talked about how we have grace, God's favor towards us, his mercy, the love of God in action, and then peace, which is the result of that. And the covenant of peace produces healing, produces prosperity, produces deliverance, produces safety, produces you being in a place of protected from the enemy and able to overcome in all areas of life. God wants us to obtain peace. We saw many principles of how we obtain this peace, this through the covenant of peace, seeing these promises and even the showers of blessings coming upon us in our life. And we also talked about conquering the hindrances as well. We also talked about the fruit of long-suffering. How important that is in dealing with people. We are to be long-suffering, and also in possessing the promises in our life. We need faith and long-suffering working together in order so we are going to be able to inherit the promises of God in our life. And we're going to continue on this morning, and we're going to talk about the next one, which the King James identifies as gentleness, but it is not gentleness. It is the fruit of active kindness and usefulness, and we will prove that to you. The King James has made many errors, and this is one where they've made a definite error. I want you to notice, first of all, I have the cursor over the word, and notice that it is number 5544 in down here in the lower window in Strong's. It is the word kratos. And it is a word which refers to, the usage of it is, it's been translated goodness four times. And it's not really goodness, because that's a different fruit. It's been translated kindness four times, which would be more accurate, good one time, and gentleness one time here. But it doesn't mean that whatsoever. When you look it up even in Strong's, and this is Strong's over here for 5544, this brings up Strong's, it speaks of usefulness and having a moral excellence because of character and demeanor, because of the fact that you are walking in kindness, a moral excellence, a usefulness in your life. When we look at it in some of the other lexicons that we have, we see the fact that it refers to a usefulness or an act of kindness, that which is someone because of uprightness within them, God wants us to have an act of kindness, to show yourself useful. One of the particular words that's a form of this refers to useful speech. Another one means to show yourself useful or to act benevolently in ways towards people. And so as you look at all this together, it means an act of kindness and of benevolence in doing something useful for another. It doesn't have anything to do with gentleness. There's different Greek words for gentleness, and we'll show you a couple of those scriptures later. We begin looking at this as, first of all, we see how God showed his act of kindness towards man. In Titus chapter 3, in verse 4, it says, "And after that the kindness," this is the word, number 5544, "after that the kindness," we're not talking about the gentleness, again, it's a mistake, "the kindness," the act of kindness, "and love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we've done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration," which is the new birth. And the washing refers to the bathing, where we've got a brand new spirit on the inside of us through new birth and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. So this is talking about that because of his kindness and his love toward us, Jesus, God, was in Christ. He's the Savior. He came and he appeared in order to bring forth his salvation. And it was according to his mercy that he saved us, bringing forth new birth, because we have to get a brand new spirit. That's the only way a man can come into relationship with God. So we see that he showed this forth by bringing salvation to mankind. It was God's act of kindness. And this had to be because the state of man was, of course, he wasn't right with God whatsoever. In Romans chapter 3, down in verse 10, it speaks of man's state. And it says, as it's written, "There's none righteous, no, not one. There's none that understandeth. There's none that seeketh after God. They're all gone out of the way. They're together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one." He says, their throat's an open sepulcher. With their tongues they use deceit. The poison of apes is under their lips, whose mouth's full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known." That's the indictment against man. No fear of God before their eyes whatsoever. That was the state of man. It's interesting, it says back here, they are together become unprofitable. This is the form of this word with a prefix a, which means not, someone who is not useful, someone who is not profitable, someone who is not walking, of course, in the ways of the Lord. And this means to be useless or to be one who is unprofitable, as it becomes, what it's translated here, or someone who's just, God can't use that person whatsoever. In fact, instead, they're a vessel of destruction, as we have seen. So all the unrighteous people, from God's standpoint, they're useless, they're unprofitable, they're not used for good, but instead they're used for evil. We all saw all the things that it listed, all the things that they will do. Yet the man in Christ is to continually come to the place of being in Christ, actively kind and profitable and useful for the Lord in serving him and in serving others. And that's what he wants. We see, even in the Old Testament, it really speaks of this over in Isaiah chapter 54. Isaiah 54, we pick up over in verse 7. He says, "For a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercies will I gather thee. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness." This is this word, Hebrew word, that's very similar to this one over in the New Testament, referring to his kindness, his act of kindness toward us. "His everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer." He said, "This is as the waters of Noah unto me, as I've sworn the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth." There won't be a destruction by a flood again. "So have I sworn that I would not be wroth with thee, nor rebuke thee. For the mountains shall depart, and the hills be removed. But my kindness," again, this is God's act of kindness, "shall not depart from thee. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath mercy on thee." When God shows forth his act of kindness, it's going to be shown in action, and that is the release of his mercy. This is the word for mercy. He shows mercy, which is the love of God in action, which for us was to bring salvation unto us. We see also this act of kindness over in Joel in the Old Testament. In Joel chapter 2, we see the state of man where verse 11, because they were turned away from the Lord, they had no fruit, they were not walking right whatsoever. He said in verse 12 of chapter 2, "Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, with mourning." They were to come to repentance, a true repentance with all their heart. "And rend your heart," otherwise get your heart right, "not your garments." They just take off their garments like it was an act of showing the fact that they'd really repented, but it's all something that comes from the heart. And he says, "Turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and he is merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness." This is this word again, hesed, which refers to a great kindness that he has toward us, "and repents him of the evil." Otherwise, God will change his mind if we will change our mind. If we will repent and walk in his ways, then he would not bring judgment upon them. The great kindness of God be shown forth. We see it also over in Jonah. In Jonah, we see in chapter 3, we pick up over here in verse 2, Jonah was told to go to Nineveh. He said, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee." Well, Nineveh was a very violent city. It was a place where there was great sin, and judgment was going to come upon it. So he arose, went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Verse 4, he began to enter into the city, a day's journey. He cried and said, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." 40 is the name, a number of testing. It is a number where they were tested in the wilderness to determine whether they would enter into the land or whether the judgment would come upon them. And so, essentially, they were given 40 days. Yet the pronouncement was that Nineveh was going to be overthrown and it was going to be destroyed. Well, what was their response to it? "The people of Nineveh believed God, proclaimed a fast, put on sackcloth from the greatest of them, even to the least of them. The word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne. He laid his robe from him, covered him with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. He caused it to be proclaimed and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, Let neither man nor beast," not even their animals, "herd nor flock," excuse me, "taste anything. Let them not feed nor drink water." They all had to fast, including the animals. No water. "Let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn every one from his evil way and from the violence that's in their hands." There was a place of violence. "Who can tell if God will turn and repent and turn away from his fierce anger that we perish not?" Well, God saw their works. They turned from their evil way, repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. Well, that displeased Jonah because he wanted to bring judgment upon him. He had a judgmental spirit about him. He was angry. He prayed unto the Lord and said, "I pray thee, O Lord, was not this my saying when I was yet in my country? Therefore I fled before unto Tarshish, for I knew that thou art a gracious God." He didn't want to do what God wanted him to do. He just wanted to see judgment. He's a gracious God and merciful and slow to anger and of great kindness. That's what God is. God is a God of great kindness, and how he would repent thee of the evil. And of course, that's what happened. They came to the place of repentance. God changed his mind, and they did not see the destruction come. God shows us the fact that he is actively kind toward us. And if we will repent, then he will not bring judgments upon us. He delights in mercy, not in judgment. He wants to bring blessings upon us. We see over in Romans chapter 2. In Romans chapter 2, we see over in verse 4, "Or despising thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering." This word goodness up here is the same word that we've seen, 55:44, sometimes translated goodness, but it's not the one for goodness. It's a different word, as you will find out when we bring the next message on the fruit of goodness. It's not talking about the fruit of goodness. This is, again, the same word referring to the act of kindness. "Despise thou the riches of his act of kindness and his forbearance, which was his toleration or of the sin that they were involved in, and his long suffering, because what did he want? He didn't want to bring judgment. He wanted them to come to repentance, not knowing that the goodness, this is a form of the word, it's number 5543, the goodness, which is referring to the active kindness and usefulness, as it says, is active kindness of God leads you to repentance. Otherwise, God will always work to try to bring you to repentance because he doesn't want to bring judgment. And so God is always actively working to get you on target so you'll walk in the ways of the Lord, so his mercy can come to you and the blessings of God will come upon you in your life. That is what he wants. His character is shown by his kind action, his benevolence in bringing us to the place of repentance. And this is one of the riches of the Lord, riches of his active kindness. And he was, of course, he wants that to be put, be established in our life as well. We see over in Psalms 117, it speaks of this because when God's act of kindness goes into operation, it's going to be coupled together with his mercy. We see in Psalms 117, verse 2, it says, "For his merciful kindness," combine this together on this word, "his kindness that produces mercy, merciful kindness is great toward us." He has great merciful kindness that he will show forth as he releases and brings forth mercy toward us in our life. We see it again in Psalms 119, over in verse 76. "Let, I pray thee, thy merciful kindness be for me comfort according to thy word and to thy servant." Again, God's kindness, merciful kindness, would bring comfort to him according to the word of the Lord. God is even shows this towards those that are not right with the Lord. In Luke chapter 6, in verse 35, he says, "Love your enemies." We're to love our enemies now in the New Testament. "Do good, lend hoping for nothing again, your reward shall be great, and you shall be the children of the highest, for he is kind." Here's this word, a form of the word, 5544, this is really the root word behind it, Christos. And this particular word, again, refers to an act of kindness. "For he is actively kind unto the unthankful and to the evil." He's even kind to those people that aren't right with him, because he is merciful to the just as well as to the unjust, which he does brings blessings upon them, even though they have no deserving of it whatsoever. And of course, because of this, it's telling us he's kind, actively kind to the unthankful and the evil, which would means that he shows mercy. And so what's he telling us to do? Show this forth by being therefore merciful as your Father also is merciful. And this word actually means here to become. It's a Greek word, ginomai. He wants you to become merciful as he is. As you are showing mercy, that shows there's active kindness in your heart. See, active kindness in your heart will always cause you to show forth some mercy in doing something, reaching out for people because of the fruit of active kindness on the inside of you. We see another scripture speaks about this. In Matthew chapter 11. In Matthew chapter 11, we'll look at three scriptures, but we'll look at the last one first, where it says, "My yoke is easy." This is the word 5543, the root word behind it. It's referring to how his yoke, which couples us together, is showing his active. There's no verb there, it's italicized. It really means my yoke is active kindness to us. And his burden is light. Because this yoke is not a yoke of bondage. It's a yoke which is showing his act of kindness toward us. And what is this yoke all talking about? We go back two verses. He says, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Jesus is our rest, and he will bring rest unto us. "Take my yoke upon me." What are we taking upon us? What is the yoke? It's covenant relationship. Covenant relationship, because that's how are we yoked together with him? In a covenant. We've come into covenant relationship when we get born again. And what do? When we have covenant relationship, we got to learn of him, the word of the covenant. And what is he going to do because of this covenant relationship? How's how we're yoked together with him, which is his act of kindness. See, God made covenant relationship so we'd see all of his blessings come to pass, because there's two parts to the covenant, you know. There's our part, the word that we're to do, and then there's all the things, the promises, the things that God says that he would do. So now that we have covenant relationship, and God swore by himself, because he could swear by none greater, that he'll perform his promises in our life, we know what he's going to do. You can know exactly what God's going to do because you have a covenant with him and the word of the covenant. So now we take his yoke, coupling together with him, which is the covenant relationship, and we learn of him by getting the word of the covenant in us, and we begin to do that, of course. He says, I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. It'll produce the spiritual rest of God, which is the possession of the promises of God in your life. For my yoke, coupling together with him, is showing forth his act of kindness, is more literally what this would refer to. It's useful for you. It could be translated here. Useful for you in the fact that it's going to bring blessings to you. You could probably translate it that way a little bit better. That my yoke is useful for you. My burden is light. It's not some heavy burden whatsoever. Because now that we've come in covenant relationship, now we can see God perform all of his promises. So the yoke is what couples us together with him, which is covenant relationship through his word. And the word of the covenant is what is useful and benevolent. It shows his act of kindness to us in showing us not only his ways as we learn of him and his promises, but showing us also how we possess those promises and enter into his rest as we find rest unto our souls. That's the promises and the blessings of God coming forth in our life. Over in Ephesians chapter 2, we see again talking about this kindness that he shows toward us. Ephesians 2 verse 7, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his Christos, the same word, his act of kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. So, one of the riches of his grace is his act of kindness shown toward us through Jesus Christ. And that's by us seeing the blessings of God because of the grace of God. When it says he might show the exceeding riches, this doesn't mean it's automatic just because you're born again. The reason is because this particular word here is a subjunctive mood, which means it's conditional. It's a conditional statement. Conditional statement based on whether you meet the conditions is whether it's going to be fulfilled. It might show, if we meet the conditions, or manifest, essentially, the exceeding riches of his grace and favor toward us in his act of kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. He's going to bring all these blessings to us. That's what he wants to do in our life. But remember, grace is conditional upon you doing what the word says if you're going to see the blessings of God come forth. Now, we also see over in 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2. In 1 Peter chapter 2, we pick up in verse 2. As newborn babes, you and I are to desire, long after, pursue after, the sincere, which is the unadulterated, pure milk of the word. So we get the word, we begin to grow up from spiritual babyhood, grow up in the things of the Lord, that you might grow thereby. If so be that you have tasted that the Lord, now here it says, is gracious. But again, this is the same word, number 5543. And it's talking about, again, if you have tasted that the Lord has been actively kind towards you, is a better translation. Because again, the word grace is a different word in the Greek. So if we're going to be, if they're precise in the translation, they wouldn't have translated it this way. Instead, it's talking about, it's shown that if we've tasted that the Lord is actively kind, because when he's actively kind toward us, what does it do? It's a release of his mercy. We see the blessings come, so we taste of it. If we taste of it, that means we experience God's act of kindness toward us. And how has he shown this act of kindness toward us? The fact that Jesus came, and what has happened? as we see in verse 4, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. Jesus was the stone who came, that became the cornerstone of the house of God. He began the building of the spiritual house of God, which is the church, of which you and I come into it when we're born again. And how is this act of kindness shown toward us? Well, you also as lively stones or living stones. You and I are stones, so to speak, in the spiritual house of God, of which Jesus is the cornerstone. And what are we doing? We are being built up. This is a word where it says build up. It's a present tense verb referring to the fact that this is an ongoing action. Present tense means continuous, repeated action. This is an ongoing action. Our being built up is the way you translate that, a spiritual house. Because the spiritual house is where God's coming to dwell in us. Through His Word, He's building things, and He's coming to make His habitation in us as the holy temple of the Lord, a holy priesthood. You and I now are priests before God, and we're to be holy priests. We offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. And we see that He's the chief cornerstone. He's the cornerstone of the house of God. And we see it comes down to verse 9. It tells us another thing that's happened. You and I are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. That's a ruling, reigning, kingly priesthood. You and I have also, the act of kindness of God has not only brought us into being a priest, but as far as a holy priest, but you and I now have been brought to be a royal priest, a king. We are kings and priests. It means we're in a position of authority. God wants you to understand you're a king and you are to rule and reign over all of your enemies, as well as be a holy nation and a peculiar, special people unto God. He show forth the praises of Him, who has called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. This is all showing the act of kindness of God. And if you've tasted of this act of kindness of God, as it's speaking of all these great things that He's done, then you have seen God bringing forth, God accomplishing great things in your life. And we even see in time past, we're not a people, but we're now the people of God. That's the act of kindness of God. We're one of the people of God now. We had not obtained mercy, but now we have obtained mercy. Mercy now belongs to us in Christ. That's why we can come boldly to the throne of grace. You and I can take hold of mercy anytime we want as a part of the promises of God that belongs to us. So you and I have tasted of this act of kindness when you and I get born again, come into the holy and the royal priesthood. We're now the spiritual house that God's building in us, and we are a holy nation, and we are coming to the place of seeing the mercy of God be manifest in our life as we take hold of promises in our life. Another thing we see over in Colossians, that this is something that you and I are to put on. Remember, it's a fruit, and all the fruit are expected to come forth in our life. We see in Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness. Here's this word, same word, 55, 44. This act of kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. And notice then, He's given us some directions of how we're going to have this fruit in our life. You're responsible to put it on. I put the cursor over the word put on. It happens to be a Greek word, enduo, which means to like sink into clothing. It's like you're putting on clothes. In fact, it really literally means to clothe oneself. And the reason that's the correct meaning of it is because this is an imperative mood, which means it's a command. You and I have been commanded to do this, to clothe ourselves. And the reason why you and I are to clothe ourselves, it's us doing it for our benefit, is because it happens to be a middle voice verb. See, the Greek is very specific about what's being said. And the middle voice in the Greek means the subject is doing the action for his benefit. Meaning, I am to put this on for my benefit. I'm responsible to put on all these things. It says, I'm the elect or chosen of God. I am to be holy and beloved. I'm to put on these bowels of mercies and compassion. This act of kindness, this is something you're to clothe yourself with. So God expects this to be put upon you in your life, as well as humbleness of mind and meekness and long-suffering. These things are so important in your life. Forbearing, that means holding up one another, forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against thee, don't ever allow yourself to get into unforgiveness. Even as Christ forgave you, so also do you. He forgave us of all of our sins. We must forgive people of their sins against us. And above all these things, you put on charity, which is love, is the word agape, translated charity here, but it means love, which is the bond of perfectness, as you and I are going to go on to perfection as we put on this fruit, all these things in our life, and especially love, of course, is the bond of perfection. So these are things that you and I are responsible to put on. Speaking of love, this is definitely something that must be in your life. The act of kindness shows forth love. In fact, if we begin here in 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, he says, though I speak with the tongue of men, tongues of men and of angels, of not charity or love, agape love, I've become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. You're like, you're going nowhere. And though I have the gift of prophecy, understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith that I could remove mountains, and if not love, I am nothing. You got to have love or you're zero. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned, if not love, it profits me nothing. We'd be profited. We'd be spinning our wheels totally in life if we don't operate in love. Then it begins to talk about characteristics of love. And the first one is act of kindness. Or second one is act of kindness. First one is long suffering. Second one is act of kindness. These are a part of the fruit because the love is shown by the fruit. Suffering long. This is long suffering. And is kind. This is the form of this word, 5544. It's 5541. Because speaking of you showing yourself to be actively kind towards others, you are to be showing yourself actively kind, a usefulness, a benevolence towards others in reaching out and ministering to people. That's what he's looking for. And you and I are to walk in love, so we should show forth this act of kindness in our life, in everything that we do. And this means that we certainly are not going to harbor evil things against anybody. In Ephesians chapter 4, we see down in verse 31 and 32. Verse 31 tells us things we need to get rid of. He says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Put it away. Get rid of it. Do not let any of these things be in your life. And what do? You're to be kind. This is the word krestos, the root word, 5543. You're to be actively kind one to another. Tender-hearted, that's compassionate, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. If you have this act of kindness, then you are going to be tender-hearted towards people. You aren't going to be harsh towards people. You aren't going to be mean towards people. You're not going to be snapping at people. You're not going to be, you know, speaking negatively at people. You're going to be tender-hearted, and you're not going to be holding anything against them. You're not going to be unforgiving. You will be forgiving one to another. That's what he wants. He expects you and I to have this act of kindness. And this is something, the word be here is become. You're to become actively kind. This is a command. God is commanding us to do it. It is to be an ongoing work because it's a present tense. So you are to continually become kind, actively kind one to another, having this fruit in your life. And that means no resentments, no bitterness, no wrath, no anger, no clamor, no evil speaking. If you are speaking evil, if you are, you know, getting angry in these things, then you don't have the fruit of act of kindness operating in your life, because that would be showing mercy towards others. In fact, even in the Old Testament, again, we see that this is what was required of them back then. In Micah chapter 6, over in verse 8, he hath showed me, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee? He's what he requires. To do justly, that's to do what is in line with justice and righteousness. To love mercy, this is this word for kindness that we saw before, translated kind or merciful kindness in the past, how he's kind to them. We're supposed to love this merciful kindness and to walk humbly with thy God. That's what God wants. That's what he requires of us. We see over in Zechariah chapter 7, verse 9. Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, execute true judgment, show or do is really what it means. This word means do. Act of kindness or merciful act of kindness is the same word translated we saw before, hesed, and compassions every man to his brother. That's what he wants. God expects you to have this act of kindness in your life. Well, the problem was they didn't have it. And so because they didn't have it, God had quite a controversy with them. He even says so over in Hosea chapter 4, verse 1. Hear the word of the Lord, you children of Israel. For the Lord hath a controversy, this means a dispute, with the inhabitants of the land, because there's no truth. Really, this word means faithfulness. It means no faithfulness. Other translations have translated this way, and I think that's a better translation here. No faithfulness, no act of kindness, again, merciful kindness, nor even have knowledge. They didn't have any knowledge or discernment of God in the land. They didn't have any, know his ways whatsoever. They were walking contrary to his ways. And of course, he later speaks to them in chapter 12, verse 6, and he says, therefore, turn thou to God. Turn to God, repent of your ways, and keep this act of kindness and this judgment or what is just, and wait on thy God continually. Otherwise, they needed to get themselves to repent from their evil ways and start showing this act of kindness and the mercy being released through them. You see, kindness is so important. We see a scripture in Proverbs chapter 19, verse 22. Look what it says. The desire of a man is his kindness. Otherwise, what this is really saying is, Young's brings it out better, the desirableness of a man is his kindness. What that means is, if you're going to be a desirable person, is you're kind. People are going to desire to be around people that are showing an act of kindness and showing mercy. People that are not showing an act of kindness and mercy, you're going to want to be around them? No, you're going to be around somebody that's mean, harsh, not nice. No, you don't want to be around those kind of people whatsoever. The desirableness of a man is his kindness. That'll make you desirable. You're looking for a mate? You better be show act of kindness. Someone's not going to want to be drawn to you if you don't show that forth. You got to have good character. That's what he's looking for in your life. Also, in the home, for the women, the virtuous woman in Proverbs 31, a couple things it speaks of her. It says she opened her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. This is this act of kindness again. In your tongue is the law of kindness. This is a spiritual law. This is supposed to be coming out of you. That means if you're speaking harshly, if you're speaking mean, if you're yelling, if you're speaking in condescending ways, you're speaking in belittling ways, you're speaking in ways that are putting people down or whatever it might be, that's not the fruit of act of kindness whatsoever. God wants the law of kindness in all of our, and here it speaks, this is a mark of a virtuous woman, that in her tongue is the law of kindness in your mouth, and that's important. We see over in 2 Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 2, in verse 19, we see another aspect of this, because part of what this also means is act of kindness produces a profitableness or a usefulness for you to be used by the Lord. What it says here in 2 Timothy 2, verse 19 and following says, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having the seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his. That implies he knows those who are not his. And then he's about to talk about the ones that are really his. Let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. The word iniquity is a word which means unrighteousness, autarkia. Young translates it better about unrighteousness. So who are the ones that are really his? The ones that they depart from unrighteousness. And all sin is unrighteousness. Therefore, they overcome and conquer all areas of sin in their life. God wants you to depart from it. And then he goes on and says, in a great house, there's not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. Well, what determines whether you're a vessel of honor or you're a vessel of dishonor? He goes on and says, if a man therefore purge, or this means to cleanse out or cleanse out thoroughly, totally cleanse out what? All the unrighteousness it's been talking about. Getting rid of this unrighteousness. That means dealing with all the sin in your life. If a man will cleanse out all this sin and unrighteousness from him, then what? Then he will be a vessel of honor. Well, what that tells you is the fact that it is the responsibility of every person to do this. And if it doesn't get done by you, because you're responsible to do it, then you're not going to be a vessel of honor. The reason you know this is because this is active voice, meaning you're responsible to purge yourself. Also, it's conditional statement about the following statement that said you'll be a vessel of honor. What's the condition? You've got to cleanse out yourself thoroughly from all the unrighteousness. Subjunctive mood means a conditional statement. If you will do these things, then you're going to be a vessel of honor. And a vessel of honor is one who will be valuable for the Lord. He's going to be sanctified because he's going to come to the place of being holy. And then it says, and meet. This is a form of the word kratos. It's a form that has a little prefix on it. E-U, you see there, you, which means well or good. And so this is talking about someone who is well, actively kind. And what this really means, it means one who is useful, as the meat for the master's use is what he calls it, or useful for the master more literally, or profitable. Young's even brings it out, profitable to the master. That would be a good translation of it. Or some translations translate it useful to the master. So this shows you the fact that what's going to make you profitable and useful for the master? That's part of the act of kindness fruit. You're to be useful for the Lord because you cleanse yourself out from all the unrighteousness. And you become a vessel of honor and you are holy before the Lord. That tells you something. How useful are you going to be for the Lord if you haven't gone through the sanctification process and come to the place of being holy, being a vessel of honor, gotten rid of all the unrighteousness and the sin? And what else will that do for you? That you'll be prepared for every good work. That means, many people say, well, yeah, I want to do the works of God. Well, if you're going to do the works of God, you got to be profitable for the master's use. You got to be useful for him. Well, if you're going to be useful for him, well, yeah, you got to be sanctified, holy. And if you're going to be sanctified, you're going to become a vessel of honor because you have purged yourself out of all this stuff. This is why it is so important for you to get cleansed out, not only for you to be free from problems in your life, but to be able to come to the place of being actively useful for him. Because the act of kindness also speaks of being able to be used of the Lord. You need this fruit in you so you're going to be used of the Lord. He wants it coming forth in your life. So this is why it's so important. In fact, those ones that had been able to be used of the Lord, God ended up using them. We see a case here where one was used. 2 Timothy 4:11. He said, only Luke is with me, but take Mark and bring him with me, for he is profitable. He's useful to me for the ministry. This guy apparently had gone through the purging process. He was sanctified and holy. He was one who became a vessel of honor at one point, and he was useful for the Lord. Unfortunately, though, just because you're useful for the Lord at one time, that doesn't mean you stay that way unless you continue to walk with the Lord. Look at what happened. You see this over in the book of Acts. In the book of Acts, in chapter 12, first we see in verse 25, this is where Paul, Barnabas, and Saul returned unto Jerusalem. When they fulfilled their ministry, they took with them John, whose surname was Mark. So they took this guy who was profitable along with him. Then, what happened after he went out on along with them in the ministry? He was profitable for them, but he didn't stick with it. Acts 15, see verse 38. Paul thought, this is when, by the way, they were ready to go forth again to go into another missionary journey to visit the cities that they'd been to. And verse 36, when Paul said to Barnabas, let us go again, visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord, see how they do. Barnabas was determined to take with him John, whose surname was Mark. Well, Paul, he said, no, we're not going to do that. Paul thought not good to take him with him, who departed from them from Pamphylia and went not with them to the work. He didn't continue on. He didn't show himself faithful and carry out what he was supposed to do. That shows you the fact that this guy wasn't useful anymore, was he? Because he backed off. He did not continue to do the things that God wanted him to do. Now, you might be one, maybe, you know, even if you ever did that, well, you can always repent and get yourself to the place where you're profitable again. And so we even see a guy in Philemon, down in verse 11, he's speaking here of Onesimus. Onesimus was one who at one time was unprofitable. He says, which in time past to thee was unprofitable. It's a form of this word, Christos. He was useless. He was unprofitable. A Christos is not useful, not one who would be profitable for me. But now he's profitable to thee and to me. Otherwise, this guy got himself on track. Perhaps he had areas of sin in his life, or wasn't walking right, or like this other guy, departed from the work, wasn't faithful. See, this act of kindness and usefulness and benevolence is not only going to be shown towards people, but it's going to be shown towards the Lord, because you are usable of the Lord, prepared into every good work, that God can use you to minister to others because you have prepared yourself and you've come to the place of being a vessel of honor, sanctified, and able to be profitable and useful for the Master. That's what he wants in your life. In fact, this is even the mark showing those ones who were approved as ministers. 2 Corinthians 6:6, if we back up, verse 4, in all things approving ourselves as the ministers of God, that they were serving him. In patience, steadfastness, afflictions, they went through pressure, necessities, distresses, they had all kinds of things that came against them. Stripes, imprisonments, tumults, labors, watchings, fastings, things that they went through of the attacks by the people that were used of the enemy, rejecting the gospel, by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, active kindness, showing themselves to be useful, showing themselves to be profitable, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by doing all these things that God told them to do. So this is also involved in showing whether you're going to be one who is profitable for ministry. We see another thing, aspect of this, over in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33. Here he talks about, be not deceived. Evil communications corrupts good manners. This is number 55, 43, a form of this. One who has had useful, profitable work done through the act of kindness of God in his life, it's produced good character, essentially. It's produced useful character. Be not deceived. Evil communication, this means companionship, who you're fellowshipping with. Bad people that you're fellowshipping with will corrupt you. It will corrupt you. It will corrupt your usefulness, your useful manners, morals, character, your way. Because what's going to happen? Well, you're going to be affected by their words. You're going to be affected by their attitudes. You're going to be affected by their demeanor. You're going to be affected by their beliefs, the things that they'll speak to you, the way they conduct themselves. That's why, are we supposed to have fellowship with the unrighteous? No. The only thing you do with them is you minister to them. You're not going to fellowship with them. They are not going to be your friends. They're going to be someone that you are ministering to. Evil companionships, someone who is not right, they will corrupt you. That's why you got to watch who you allow your children around. You don't let your children get around people that are going to be evil. They're going to affect them adversely. You let them around someone who even puts in evil things into them, it's going to affect them adversely. You've got to work to protect your children, protect, and of course, yourself. Stay away from people that are would be destructive in some particular way to you. You know, this can also apply If you have for children, you know, you certainly keep them away from evil. But let's say you have a situation where you have an unbelieving spouse, or you have an ex-spouse, or you have a disobedient spouse or whatever, and they're going to be around them, and they're going to be pouring a bunch of evil things. You're going to have to pour the word into them and to teach them to counteract the negatives as you see them coming into them, because certainly you can't keep them away from a spouse. You know, they have rights to them. But you got to be wise and learn how to minister to those things, because you got to know evil things are going to come in and try to corrupt them away from the useful, profitable things that God's putting in their life in order to bring forth good fruit, of course, and good things in their life. So watch who you're around. It will corrupt you from you the good things or the useful things that God has put in you in your life. We see another thing. Even interesting, it uses this word over in Romans chapter 16 in verse 17 and 18, where it says, I beseech you, brethren, mark them that cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine that you've learned, and avoid them. You know, you got to watch who you're around. People that are teaching you contrary to doctrine, you're supposed to avoid them. Turn aside, shun them, stay away from them, not have fellowship with them. It's a mistake. But they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, if they're not bringing forth the true doctrine. Well, they say they're born again, so just because they're born again doesn't mean they're serving the Lord. If they're not bringing true doctrine, they're not serving the Lord. They're serving the enemy, whether they realize it or not. But their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches. Here, by good words, and this word here is the word, a form of this word, number 5542. By their nice, kind words or fair speaking words, supposedly useful words, and fair speeches, what do? They'll deceive the hearts of the simple. That's why you cannot be listening to or around people that are teaching you false doctrine. It will affect you. You think it won't? It will. The old thing that says, well, you know, you just eat the meat and spit out the bones. Sorry, it doesn't work that way. That's just a blind teaching. What comes into you has come into you. It's there. What you hear has come into your heart. What you're seeing, these things that you're allowing, are coming into you. They're going to affect you. That's why you need to guard yourself. Jesus even said, take heed what you hear. Why would he say that? Because he didn't want you to hear things because it's going to get into your heart. That's why you got to guard yourself. You know, people think, well, I'll just learn all these different things, you know, and that's a mistake. You only want to learn the things that are in line with the truth, that are in line with the Word of God. Otherwise, and oh, they seem like they've got good, nice, you know, good words, fair speeches, you know, useful, good things that they're bringing forth. It's bringing deception. It'll deceive your heart, and it'll lead you away from the truth. The Bible says very clearly, if anybody is bringing anything contrary to the true doctrine and the teaching that you've learned, avoid them. And this word avoid, by the way, it's not a suggestion. It is a command, imperative mood. It is a command. You have been commanded to avoid them. And again, this word avoid means to turn away from them. Turn away from. Keep away from them. Turn yourself away. Shun a person. Turn aside. Otherwise, don't have fellowship with them. You're going to be affected. I see too many people are affected by hearing wrong things, and they make a mistake. And then they get off track on things. And that's a big, big mistake. One of the scriptures we looked at earlier, but we want to go back to it for a moment, showing you this act of kindness work. When it talks about the riches of his goodness and forbearance, this was act of kindness, not knowing that the act of kindness, this is the word again, of God leads you to repentance. God's act of kindness will always work to bring you to repentance, to change your mind, to turn away from a wrong way and to choose a right way. Therefore, God wants us. So you see, there's an act of kindness not only towards people, but it's an act of kindness towards God as well in obeying him because of what he's done for you. God wants to lead you to repentance so you'll walk in his ways so he can bring his blessings upon you in your life so you won't be walking in wrong ways. In fact, we can even see this over in Romans chapter 11. Verse 22. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God. The severity is the judgment of God that's going to come on people that aren't walking right. On them which fell, severity. They fall, severity. Toward thee, goodness, if thou continue in his goodness. Otherwise, you shall be cut off. Because what severity meant? They got cut off. I was talking about the Jews. They got cut off because they didn't receive the gospel, did they? What's this got to do with it? The word goodness is this word 5544. Behold, therefore, the act of kindness and the severity of God. His act of kindness was to bring his word to us. We receive it. We come into covenant relationship. We get born again. He brings his word to us, and so we take hold of the promises and walk in them and walk in fellowship with him, overcome sin, you know, come to the place of being holy before him. All these things that God does in our life bring forth fruit. The guys that fell, severity, but towards thee, goodness. But then he says, this is the act of kindness. If you continue in his act of kindness. In other words, how do you continue in his act of kindness? By doing his word. So that you can see God accomplish this work continually in your life. You just don't get, that's like the guy gets born again and then walks in the ways of the world and the flesh and everything and thinks he's okay. He's not continuing in the things that God has brought forth, the act of kindness, the work of God in our life. We must continue it. Otherwise, we could be cut off. It's quite a statement. You are to continue in the act of kindness of God. Now, if you did make some mistakes, God is a God who forgives, doesn't he? Verse 23, they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, the Jews have gotten unbelief, they shall be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. Now they can come back if they will come to the place of belief. Otherwise, if you come to the place of repentance and you get on track and start walking with the Lord again, then he'll bring you back in. Of course, you will have fellowship again with him. We see another aspect of this word in relation to being a profitable servant for the Lord. Because this act of kindness and usefulness and profitableness is not only God toward us and us toward God and also towards other people. It also involves us to be able to be effective in ministry and used of the Lord. Luke 17, here it's talking about increasing our faith. The whole subject is about faith. And if they had faith as a grain of mustard seed, they'd say in the sycamine tree, be thou plucked up by the root, be thou planted in the sea, it should obey you. And now he's continuing on. He hadn't changed the subject. He's still talking about faith. Which of you having a servant? What's our servant? Our faith. It's been given to us to service. If you have a servant, plowing or feeding cattle, a servant that's supposed to be doing something for you, are you going to say to him by and by when he's come from the field, go and sit down to meat? No. You're going to rather say to him, make ready where thy sup and gird thyself and serve me till I've eaten and drunk, and afterward you'll eat and drink. Otherwise, you're my servant, you're going to do this. Otherwise, you're going to make sure your servant is put to work to do things. Does he thank that servant because he did the things that were commanded him? I trow. This means I think not. Well, he goes on and says, so likewise, when you've done all these things which are commanded you, now he's bringing it over unto us because it speaks of faith as your servant who's doing what you command to be done because your faith, you release it with commanding words, remember. That's the way you put it in operation, like saying into the mountain or saying to the sycamine tree. And now he says, comes over to you, he says, we are unprofitable servants. We've done that which is our duty to do. The word unprofitable is a form of this word for the kratos. It's the word akrios. It's got the prefix on it, meaning someone who is useless or not profitable or good for nothing. Showing the fact that if you and I are not doing the things that he wants us to do, then what does that mean? We essentially are unprofitable. We are useless for him. Servants that do their duty are profitable and useful. Otherwise, I'm a doer of the word. I'm a doer of the work. I'm carrying out the ministry. I'm showing the act of kindness. I'm prepared unto every good work. I'm showing mercy towards others. I'm ministering for the Lord. That's the one who's profitable. But if you're not doing what the Word says, then you're an unprofitable one. Say, well, okay, I see that. What's that got to do with me? It's got lots to do with you, because this is the state of what happens for the unprofitable servant. Strong word. Matthew 25:30 says, cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. They'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Because you're commanded to do the works of God in the service of the Lord. This guy was the unprofitable one. This guy wasn't doing it. Remember, this guy had the talents? Hey, he buried his talent. He didn't do what God told him to do. He didn't use what God told him to use. See, you have a ministry, and you're to fulfill the ministry and the calling of God upon your life and the things He wants you to do. We're all commanded to go and preach the gospel and minister for the Lord, be vessels for Him. And take this, the guy that said, take the talent away from him, give it to him as 10 talents, because he didn't use what he was given. And so that's why he comes down here and he says, what's the result of this guy? Cast the unprofitable, the useless, good for nothing. He didn't have the fruit of act of kindness toward God or on behalf of God in ministering to other people. He wasn't a servant of the Lord. He goes into outer darkness. There's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And say, well, what was the problem here? When the Son of Man comes in His glory, all the holy angels with Him will sit upon the throne of His glory. They'll gather all the nations. They're going to separate the sheep from the goats. The sheep are the ones who follow Him closely and do what He says. The goats are wandering out doing whatever they want to do. Sets the sheep on the right hand, goats on the left. He says to the ones on the right hand, the sheep, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. And now what about these guys? What made them okay that they're going to come into the kingdom? I was a hungry and you gave me meat. Thirsty, you gave me drink. Stranger, you took me in. Naked, you clothed me. Sick, and you visited me. Prison, and you came to me. These guys were doing the works, weren't they? They were showing active kindness towards people. They were profitable and useful, and they were carrying out the service of the Lord. And they said, when did we see you all these things? And he comes down here, and he says, inasmuch as you've done it to one of the least of my brethren, you've done it unto me. Make sure you've done it to at least one of the least of the brethren in your lifetime. And then he says to the other guys, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Oh, these guys are the ones that are in trouble. They're the unprofitable servant that didn't obey him. What happened with them? You were hungry, you gave me no meat. Thirsty, you gave me no drink. Stranger, took me not in. Naked, you didn't clothe me. Sick and in prison, you didn't visit me. He said, Lord, when saw we thee all these things? Didn't minister to thee. He said, verily I say unto it, insomuch you did it not to one of the least of these, you did it not to me. These guys are in trouble. These shall go away into everlasting punishment. That's the unprofitable servant, the one who's useless, but the righteous unto life eternal. God wants you to be a servant of the Lord and to do the things that He wants you to do. If you will follow Him, you're going to see blessings come forth. It is important to follow not only the way of righteousness, but also showing forth active kindness. In fact, we see a scripture showing the promise of this. Proverbs 21 is pointing towards this in verse 21. He that followeth after righteousness and mercy, this is the word hesed again, which refers to his act of kindness showing mercy, the merciful kindness. The one who's following after that, and this means pursuing, running after it, this word, radof. What's he going to find? He's going to find life. He's going to have eternal life. He's going to find righteousness. The fruits of the right is going to be declared to be righteous. He's going to get honor. He's going to be honored by the Lord. That means you and I need to be following not just only after righteousness, but also after active kindness of showing mercy to others. And that's important because He expects us to be a servant of the Lord. Also, think of some of the scriptures, the results of what this will produce in your life, just by way of remembrance, what we talked about in Matthew chapter 11. Remember what happens? The guy who is yoked together with Him, what happens? He finds rest unto his souls. as you are showing this, you are going to see God's blessings come upon you. The covenant promises will bring rest unto your soul. And you're going to see these riches of His grace towards you. Remember, we saw this in Ephesians chapter 2, over in verse 7, where He said, in ages to come, He'll show the exceeding riches of His grace in His kindness toward us. That means that's ongoing action. If we meet the conditions, He'll show His continual riches of His favor. The favor of God will be coming toward us. We saw that scripture in Proverbs 19:22 about the desirableness of a man is his kindness. You'll be a desirable one. You'll be desirable to the Lord. You'll be a virtuous woman. We saw that. And also we saw in 2 Timothy 2, we'll be profitable and useful to the master, prepared into every good work, because we become a vessel of honor, because we have done the things that He said. We'll be profitable for our ministry as well. In fact, if we go back to Matthew 25, we saw the guy who's in trouble. The guy in verse 31, In verse 30 it was. The unprofitable servant cast into darkness. But what if you were doing what he says? Well done, thou good and faithful servant, if we're a servant of the Lord. You've been faithful over a few things. I'll make the ruler over many things. God wants you to be faithful. Faithful. Those ones who are actively showing kindness toward God and carrying out the ministry that He's called, and they need to be faithful. Remember the guy started out with Paul, and now this guy is not useful or profitable because he didn't continue. We're not taking him the next time. In fact, there was such a contention between Paul and Barnabas about that they split. And after that, you never heard from Barnabas again the rest of the book of Acts, because he didn't do the right thing. You see what Paul did, because he chose what was right. God is looking for us to have the fruit of active kindness in our life, towards God, towards man, and also being shown forth in ministry, your profitableness, your usefulness in carrying out the service of the Lord, being a servant of God. That is all involved in this fruit of active kindness, usefulness, and profitableness, which is what He's going to bring forth in your life. And we're going to get rid of all the sin. We're going to be vessels of honor. We're going to put this on. We're going to clothe ourselves with it. Remember, all these things are important. We're going to get rid of all the anger, resentment, bitterness. That's all going to shut down your effectiveness, because you got to have good character. You got to have right character to be useful for the Lord. Say this: Heavenly Father, I thank You and praise You for Your word that brings revelation of the fruit of active kindness and usefulness unto You and towards others. I thank You for this fruit being developed in me. I will show forth active kindness just as You've shown active kindness toward me. You brought salvation to me. You brought me to repentance. You delivered me out of evil things. Your riches of Your goodness, of active kindness, brought me to the place of turning towards You. I thank You. Just as Your merciful kindness has been great towards me, and You are kind, even unto the unthankful and to the evil, I will show forth act of kindness towards everybody that I come in contact with. And I will show mercy, which is the result of having act of kindness established in my life. I also thank You because of the yoke of covenant relationship that I have with You, that I now can see Your act of kindness manifest in my life as I possess the promises, and I will find rest for my soul as You will heal me and deliver me and set me free. I also thank You that the riches of Your grace will be shown to me in Your act of kindness when I meet the conditions. I thank You for all that You've done in my life. It has been Your act of kindness and Your mercy shown to me, and bringing me to be born again, to be a holy priest, to be a royal priest, for all the work You're doing in my life. I will put on and clothe myself with active kindness so I am profitable and useful for you. I will walk in love and show myself actively kind, benevolent, reaching out to others, showing mercy to them. I will become kind, actively, one to another. I will put away all anger, all resentment, all bitterness, all evil speaking. I will obey what you require, which is the love act of kindness and showing mercy. And I will show it to others. I will be seen to be one desired. For the women, I will have the law of kindness in my mouth. So I will be a virtuous woman. And I will be a vessel of honor, sanctified, useful and profitable for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. I thank you, Lord. I will show myself faithful in carrying out the work of the Lord. And I will have myself prepared to be used of the Lord. I thank you, Lord, for your goodness. And I will be a servant that will show myself to be profitable and useful for you, because I will serve you and do what you want me to do. I will show forth act of kindness and mercy in my life because I serve you and carry out the ministry that you've called me to. Thank you for this fruit of act of kindness developed in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. I trust this has helped you. It's quite different from if you've heard teachings on thinking that it's just talking about gentleness. It doesn't have anything to do with gentleness. It all is an action thing. And it all shows a mercy. And it shows action on your part towards others, toward God, and in carrying out the ministry of the Lord. Father, we thank you for all that you brought forth. Thank you for the revelation of the fruit of active kindness. We will see it manifest in our life as we're hearers and doers of the word, so that we will see your blessings come and will be profitable and useful for you. And we will be those ones that are true servants of the Lord. Father, thank you for the development of this in each one's life as we hear and do this word in Jesus' name. Amen.